one and VLI.
A very good afternoon to one and all. Respected head of the department, Dr. Gauri Vahalkar ma'am, our esteemed guest speaker, Dr. Preeti Amritkar madam from EnviroCare Labs, my colleagues, Ms. Subhashini Maharana and Ms. Suhana Kolavur, and my dear participants, I welcome you all for the webinar on LC-MS-MS basics and its applications into food industries. Before I hand over to our HOD for introducing our guest speaker, I would like to make a small announcement regarding the certificates. The link for the feedback form will be provided in the chat box as well as in the description box towards the end of the session, as well as in the WhatsApp group. The students will have to duly fill up the feedback form, and you will be getting the certificates in the 15 days time period. Any queries before that will not be entertained. We expect full support from you. Thank you so much. I would now hand over to Gauri ma'am to introduce our guest speaker for today.
Okay. Thank you, Aditi. I will take opportunity to introduce today's speaker. That is Dr. Preeti Amritkar. She is Director Labs of EnviroCare. She is the director towards the EnviroCare Labs, which are situated at Thane. About the qualification, she is PhD in Chemical Technology, received scholarships under UGC, Government of India, as Senior Research Fellow, Junior Research Fellow, thrice, and also she is qualified GATE IIT in 1998. About EnviroCare, quality and technical functions of food and environment testing lab, accredited by NABL, recognized by BIS, APEDA, EGMARK, approved by Ministry of Environment and Forest, Government of India, with ISO 9001:2008. Testing includes chemical and instrumental analysis of food, water, environmental for metals, pesticides, veterinary drugs, vitamins, minerals, etc. EnviroCare doing around 75,000 samples per year with the help of 125 plus scientists, samplers, lab, and their admin executives. So EnviroCare has its satellite labs situated in Pune as well as Nashik, and branches are in Aurangabad and Goa too. Madam is faculty member for various training courses on advanced instrumentation such as gas chromatography, HPLC, AS, and so on. In her credit, there are a lot of publications and presentations. I'll be making a few of their list. Validation of AOAC official methods 2010-11 for vitamin B12 in Indian infants and pediatric formulas and adult nutritions. Analysis of food soluble, fat soluble vitamin E and E in edible oil. She has worked on challenges with fortification of food, new trends in food analysis and chromatography analysis, as well as MS. Determination of residual pesticides in pasteurized cow milk using GC-MS-MS. Sugar replacement, that is replace that sugar naturally. She has so many courses and workshop in her credit. She has conducted advanced LC-MS-MS applications in food analysis conducted by Lab India Life Sciences in Gurgaon in February 2009, HPLC tools for food analysis, advanced GC-MS-MS applications on pesticides on Polaris Q for pesticide residue analysis, lab quality management system, and internal auditor as per ISO 17025:2005. She is the member of professional bodies such as UDCT alumni, AOIC, AFSTI, etc. She is doing freelancing for All India Radio, newspapers, and scientific magazines. And she is also a referee or judge for evaluation of thesis for masters as well as doctoral degrees for Mumbai University. So with this bio data, I welcome Director Labs to EnviroCare, Dr. Preeti Amritkar.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gauri, for this big introduction.
Now it's a very, very great responsibility on me to fulfill whatever you have read about me. So yeah, so let us quickly start the webinar. So this is about understanding the basics of LC-MS/MS and how we can use LC-MS/MS in food analysis in food industry. So chromatography, as you all know, is a Greek word and it means color drawing. So basically, there was a Russian botanist called Tsvet who has separated chlorophyll pigments on a chalk powder. And what he obtained was that different layers of colors. And that's why he named the experiment as color drawing. And that's how the term chromatography was coined. So from there on, the journey of chromatography in science started. Initially, they thought that it was an art. But it is actually a science. We can use it, use chromatography for our various separation techniques. So the principle of chromatography is very simple. It is very, very analogous to liquid-liquid extraction. I'm sure all students who are attending this webinar have carried out liquid-liquid extraction in some way or the other, wherein you mix two immiscible liquids together. And the analyte of interest preferably travels in one or the other phase, depending on its solubility. So you can imagine that chromatography is very similar to liquid-liquid extraction. It is just that in chromatography, not both the phases are moving. One phase is stationary and the second phase is moving. The moving phase is the mobile phase and the stationary phase is the solid phase. Okay. So this is a basic, very, very basic principle of chromatography. And it is just like any other separation technique that you use in the lab. So it could be filtration, it could be extraction, osmosis, anything. It is just a separation technique which separates two or more constituents. Okay, so this is just a brief introduction. Like, a lot of people do not know what exactly, how exactly the stationary phase and mobile phase and the analytes, all of them work. So now imagine that I've shown the boxes here. They are nothing but the stationary phase. The peach color thing, that is the stationary phase, and the gray color is representing mixture of solutes. So if you have a stationary phase and if you pour onto it a mixture of solutes, what happens is that, for example, when you go in a party, okay, there are so many people in the party, but you stop to talk to a particular person some more time. You spend some more time with the people whom you like. Okay, so it's the same way. So now what is happening here is that some of the solutes, okay, like you can see here, the green one, okay, the green particular solute is not really, liking the stationary phase. Therefore, it is coming out very fast. You can see that the peak of the green analyte is coming out fast. Okay, so it is the least that is retained. Then follows the purple one and then is the red one. So the red one has the maximum affinity for the stationary phase. So that's how a chromatogram has to be read. The analyte that elutes the first has the least affinity for the stationary phase. Okay. Now there are various types of stationary phases. Okay. I will not go into the details of all of them because it's a very basic thing in HPLC, and therefore we'll just move on to the introduction of LC-MS/MS. Now, generally, if you have heard this term front end, all of the engineers, they call HPLC as the front end, and it is the front end of the LC-MS/MS. So the basic parts of HPLC, all of them would be there in LC-MS/MS also. Like, you have the mobile phase reservoir, okay, you have A, B, C, D, you have, a binary pump or a quaternary pump. So that is all there. Solvent delivery system, that's the pump. Then the sample introduction device, okay, which is an auto sampler or injector. Then there is a stationary phase, which is the heart of the entire HPLC and LC-MS/MS system as well. Then comes the detector, and then is the computer. Okay. So now this detector is what is different in case of LC-MS/MS. Rest, all of the things are same. This detector, instead of using a UV or a PDA detector, or you use RID, that is refractive index detector, for sugar analysis. So instead of all those detectors, you just use mass spectrometry as your detector, mass spectrometer as your detector. This is LC-MS/MS. Okay. So now what we are going to see today is more details about this detector. So LC-MS/MS is a hyphenated technique. What do you mean by hyphenated technique? Generally, mass spectrometer has been used as a standalone detector as well. So when you combine or when you use the individual detectors together, okay, like there's HPLC and there is mass spectrometer, when you use both these techniques together, it is called as a hyphenated technique. Okay, and hyphenated technique has a great power, separation power, okay, because it combines the separation power of LC-MS/MS and detection power of mass spectrometry. Okay, now there are three basic parts of any LC-MS/MS. The first is the ionization source, okay, the next is mass analyzer, and the third is the detector. LC-MS/MS, although I said that it's a detector in itself, it also has a detector. Okay, so the third part is the detector. Now this is just a simple flow diagram. Okay, so we have the inlet. You can see the working of LC-MS/MS is divided into three steps. The first part is the production of the ionized molecules, ionized species, I can say. Okay, now you know that in the HPLC, what you do, just HPLC I'm talking about, your eluent, okay, is in the liquid state. The eluent that you're using, you may be using water, acetonitrile, methanol, a combination of that. Okay, so all that is in the liquid state. Now, when I say that production of charge, gas, phase, ions, ionization, you're talking about gas phase. So you have to remember that the mobile phase that is coming out of HPLC has to be evaporated, okay, at some stage. So just remember that. Then comes the sorting of ions, that is filtering of ions, selecting what you want, what you don't want. Okay, the next is the detection. Okay, so you can see here that there is the, in the diagram, you can see that there is an inlet on the left hand side from where the sample is introduced. So basically it will go through HPLC and it will come out through the column, and then it will go to the source. Okay, source is the first part of the mass spectrometer. Okay, so now in the source, what happens is that, as I said, the liquid, that is liquid eluent, is converted into gas phase. So your analyte, your solvent, everything is into gas phase. Okay, so you produce gas phase ions here. Then next is you go to analyzer. Analyzer, as the name suggests, it will analyze everything and it will sort. Okay, it will sort the ions. The third is the ion detection. Okay, and then it will go to data system, to computer, to software, and it will give you an output, which is nothing but a mass spectrum. Okay, so this is just a brief diagram of LC-MS/MS. Now let us first come to ionization. Ionization, as the name suggests, its function, the ion source, the function is to generate ions. Okay, carry out ionization. Now LC-MS/MS separates gas phase ions, okay, according to their mass to charge ratio. We have converted the eluent to a gas phase. Now these gas phase ions will be separated, okay, according to their mass to charge ratio. So for any spectrometer, mass spectrometer, the principle of working is sorting of mass to charge ratio, which is known as M by Z. So you take GC-MS/MS, it's the same principle. Okay, so the charged species are produced by ionization, and then how these molecules are produced. Okay, there are three methods basically. The first method, how the ionization takes place, there are three methods: electrospray ionization, then is the atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, and for macromolecules like peptides, proteins, oligosaccharides, which are big molecules, you cannot use electrospray or APCI, that is atmospheric pressure chemical ionization. You have to use something which is suitable for the large molecules, which is MALDI, that is matrix associated laser desorption ionization. Okay, so there are many other techniques as well, but these are the ones which are commonly used. In fact, ESI and MALDI are the ones which are widely used in food industry. Okay, now ionization. Okay, we are saying that ionization will generate ions. Okay, now when ionization is happening, what can happen is that either an electron get added or removed. Okay, or in short, either it can work by protonation or deprotonation. Okay, so it depends on the molecule that you are analyzing. Some molecules tend to take a proton, and some molecules tend to deprotonate themselves. So depending on the molecule, you will either get protonated or a deprotonated molecule, and this information can be obtained through literature survey, because we are dealing with a lot of molecules which are already studied by someone else. So literature survey is a very important activity that a student must do before taking up the research activity. Now these ions, how are they produced? Okay, they are produced by using strong electric fields in the vapor or in the condensed phase. When I say condensed phase, this is a liquid phase. Okay. Now, when the ionization is carried out in the condensed state, that is in the liquid state, it is called as electrospray ionization. And when it is carried out in the vapor phase, that is in the gas phase, it is called atmospheric pressure chemical ionization. We will see the details again here. Okay. Now, any ionization technique you take, as I said, this is the ionized form of the molecule. So you can either have M plus or you can have M minus. But the molecule that is generated after the ionization, okay, is known as molecular ion. Okay, this is known as M plus or M minus. Okay. And you have to also remember that ESI, APCI, MALDI, all of these are soft ionization techniques in the sense that the energy that is transferred because of this process, because of this ionization, is really very negligible. So unlike in the gas chromatography, okay, anybody who is aware of GC, MS, MS techniques, 70 electron volt energy is applied to every molecule, and the molecule is absolutely fragmented. It is broken, okay, in multiple parts. That does not happen in LC, MS, MS. And therefore, these techniques are known as soft ionization techniques. So we've done, this is the basics of ionization, okay? And we will now see electrospray ionization. So in electrospray ionization, three important steps again. The first, that eluent that is coming out of the HPLC outlet, okay? So that eluent is passed to the source. Now here, production of charged droplets is happening at the capillary tip, okay? Then it means that the first, what you are doing is that you are charging, okay? You are charging your liquid phase. So as I said earlier also, the ionization is happening in the condensed state, that is in the liquid state itself. So first the charge is imparted to the liquid coming out from the HPLC. After that, once the ionization, once the charge is acquired by the particles or the droplets, then the desolvation, that is evaporation, okay? Desolvation of droplets take place. And then that is followed by production of gas phase ions. So first the eluent is charged, okay, it is ionized, and then it is desolvated and it goes into the gas phase. Okay, this is the process for electrospray. So this is depicted here. We can see that there is a spraying nozzle. There is a very, very thin nozzle, okay, very, very minute nozzle from where the eluent of the HPLC is coming in, okay, and then that is actually forced to pass through this small nozzle, okay. And what happens is that there's a Taylor cone you can see there, and you can also see the charged parent droplet. Okay, so when it is coming from the spraying nozzle itself, you can see that there's a power supply written and there is a positive negative ends written. So it is getting charged at that point itself when it's in the condensed state. Then when it comes out, because it is coming out from a very small nozzle, okay, it forms aerosols kind of a thing, and the charged droplets you can see there. These droplets now are provided heat, okay? They're heated. So there is a nebulizer gas that comes in, okay? And it actually evaporates the solvent. And when the solvent is evaporated, what is happening, you can see that the size of the droplet is reducing, okay? You can also see the word there, charged droplet at the Rayleigh limit, okay? I'll tell you what the Rayleigh limit is, not going into much details, but just for your reference. And this charged droplet then splits into multiple small droplets, okay? And these small droplets or these small ionized species then enter in the quadrupole one, okay? So this is the basic of electrospray ionization. I just told you that Taylor cone and Rayleigh limit, these are two new phrases. Just want to know, let you know that Taylor was a scientist and he studied the shape of the cone formed by the fluid droplet under the effect of an electric field, okay? And therefore the name is like that, Taylor cone. So characteristic droplet shape, therefore they named it after Taylor, and that is why it is known as Taylor cone. Also you have to remember that there was this scientist Lord Rayleigh, okay, who actually estimated the maximum amount of a charge a liquid droplet could carry. It is not that the liquid droplet can carry any amount of charge, finally it is going to break after a certain point. So he decided theoretically what is that limit. So you cannot say that a particle which is charged, okay, will remain like that forever. It is going to break up when it keeps acquiring charge. So that is what is really meant by Rayleigh limit. So when you have a charged particle like this here, okay, it will finally split into very, very small particles, positive particles. And that is what this diagram shows. The next is the atmospheric pressure chemical ionization. Now in APCI, it is called as APCI. The eluent is introduced into the interface, okay, using a capillary. Okay, just we have a small capillary, I told you, the same capillary. But no potential is applied to the capillary. Okay, ionization, like the charge, giving the charge to the droplet is not happening here. Okay, what is happening instead is that the liquid comes out from the capillary, okay, and it is heated. A nebulizer gas is passed and it is heated. And it is heated so that the solvent from coming out from the HPLC evaporates. Once the evaporation is done, okay, the combination of nebulizing gas and heat, okay, forms an aerosol. It evaporates. And then after it evaporates, goes in the gas phase, you have a pin, okay, that is placed within the heated region and it has a high potential applied to it. And that pin, okay, then produces electrical discharge that ionizes the eluent molecules. So in APCI, what is happening is that the liquid eluent that is coming out is first getting evaporated to gas phase and then it is getting charged. Whereas in ESI, the liquid is first coming out, it is getting charged and then it is getting evaporated, a slight change, okay, but it can make so much of difference, okay. This is the diagram that theoretically shows. You can see that from HPLC unit, sample and mobile phase, both are coming out. They're getting heated up by the nebulizer gas and then transferred to gas phase and then they're getting charged by the corona discharge needle, okay. So that's how this APCI ionization works. The next is the MALDI, okay, matrix associated laser desorption ionization. Now you know that when you are dealing with this ESI and APCI is all right when you are dealing with small molecules. Small molecules in the sense the molecular weight, which is not really very high, just less than 1000 daltons or so. But when you are dealing with proteins, peptides, okay, hormones, etc., these are basically very fragile molecules. And also is that like some molecules like oligosaccharides, okay, they do not get ionized very easily, okay. And the important factor is that they are fragile. So when you imagine that you are heating up the sample containing proteins or DNA or peptides, what will happen to the molecule of interest, okay, or analyte of interest? It is going to get deactivated because they are finally proteins. So it will be just deactivated. So therefore, the routine techniques of ESI and APCI will not be applied to, cannot be applied, in fact, to proteins and peptides. And therefore, scientists came up with some different idea, okay, some different technique of ionization for these molecules, for these kind of analytes. Now, what is happening here is that the sample that has this either DNA or protein or whatever, the sample is mixed with a suitable matrix material and applied to a metal plate. Okay, so what I can do is I can just show you the figure first. You can see on the left hand side is the target plate, that's a metal plate, and on that plate you have the green molecules. Okay, these green molecules are nothing but the matrix spots. We will see what matrix it is. Okay, so there could be different types of matrix that are used. So these green matrices, they are there, and in those matrices you have mixed your sample. It could be a protein sample, it could be a DNA sample. So you mix the matrix and the analyte together, okay, and you keep it on the target plate. Now what happens is that a laser beam is applied, okay, to the metal plate. The laser beam basically gives UV light, okay, UV light to the entire plate. Now what is happening is that you know that proteins or peptides or DNA, etc., they will not directly absorb the UV radiation. But the green spots, you can see the matrix spots, these are the substances which actually very, very effectively absorb UV light, okay. And therefore what happens is that they are selected in such a way, we will also see the properties of matrices. So these matrix spots, they actually absorb the laser beam, heat of the laser beam, and they evaporate. So when they evaporate, they also take with them the analyte spots. Okay, so you can see the next figure wherein the desorption is happening. So it is coming out of the metal plate and the analyte you can see in between, and it is covered by the matrix spots. So the matrix has taken analyte along with it. Okay, and then the dissolution and ionization is can. See, the important thing here is to understand is that it is very difficult to get the peptide or a DNA molecule in the gas phase. So that is done with the help of matrix. Okay, and then the routine process of ionization will follow. Like then you provide some heat. It is not, of course, the heat that you provide in electrospray or APCI, but it will be a little lesser version of the heat, this thing, and then you take it to mass analyzer. So basically what is happening here is that the sample is mixed with the suitable matrix material, and the pulse laser irradiates the sample, and because of which the desorption of the sample and the matrix material happens. The analyte molecules are ionized by being protonated or deprotonated. That protonation or deprotonation again depends on the type of molecule that you are analyzing, and then it is taken to the mass spectrometer. Okay, this is just one another example. When you can see now that on the left hand side, initially you can see that there is an analyte and there is a matrix, and on the right hand side you can see that some part of the analyte and the matrix is now gone in the gas phase. Now, what is this matrix? Matrix is any compound that is able to absorb UV radiation. Generally, laser beam consists of either UV or IR radiation. Generally, UV is used, and therefore you can see that all these compounds, nicotinic acid, picolinic acid, these are all compounds which can absorb UV very well. Okay, so you can also see the applications of particular matrix compound. This is just an example. I mean, you will find so many of them in the literature. So for oligonucleotides, you can use picolinic acid. For oligosaccharides, you can also use 3-aminoquinoline, etc., etc. Okay. Now, what are the, can we use any other matrix? So you can decide that depending on these properties. So the matrix that you choose, okay, should have following properties. First, it should be of low molecular weight. Okay, it should also have a low vapor pressure. Okay, but low vapor pressure, but it should not vaporize during sample preparation. Okay, it should be acidic so that generally it can protonate, and it should also have a strong optical absorption in either UV or IR range. So generally the matrices that you choose should have these properties. Now once this is done, you can say that your protein or DNA is getting ionized. The next is the mass analyzer. The mass analyzer is the heart of the entire detector, because it does a very important function of sorting the ions. Okay, and there are three different types of mass analyzers. And this is decided based on the way they separate the ions. The first is the quadrupole mass analyzers. The second is time of flight analyzers. The third is the ion trap mass analyzers. There are others also, like there is Orbitrap, okay, and there is ion cyclotron. There are so many other mass analyzers also, but I have only selected these three because these are widely used, and these are of interest probably to the research students. Now, before we go into the details of that, let us quickly see the terms that are used. The first term is the molecular ion, which is same as the precursor ion. Okay, so I said that either protonated or deprotonated. So this is this precursor ion. The ionized form of the molecule or molecular ion is the precursor ion, and the precursor ion dissociates, okay, to a smaller fragment ion due to collision induced dissociation mass spectrometry. So the precursor ion is afterwards, when it goes in the mass in the CID, that is in the collision cell, the precursor ion is going to divide into multiple small fragments, and that is the precursor ion. So after that you have the product ion. So the precursor ion, when I said that it forms multiple small ions, these are the product ions. Okay, so these are formed from precursor ion because of collision. Okay, and collision is happening with the help of a gas. Okay, so every vendor will have different gas. Some use argon, some use nitrogen. Okay, so but there is a gas that is used for collision. The next is the scan. Scan is like you run a normal HPLC. In that fashion only you run your MS. So the entire chromatogram can be seen. Okay, the next is the SIM mode. That is a single ion monitoring. So that is, you only select a particular transition, okay, and you just monitor that particular transition. And MRM is nothing but multiple reaction monitoring. So instead of analyzing only one single molecule, you will analyze multiple molecules at the same time. That is MRM. Okay, so MRM is the fastest way of analyzing multiple components. Let us see what these quadrupole mass analyzers are. So in these analyzers, electric fields are applied. Okay, electric fields are applied to the the allylites, okay, to separate the ions according to their mass to charge ratio as they pass along the central axis of four parallel rods or poles. Some vendors, some instrument manufacturers, they also have octapoles, not four parallel rods, they have eight parallel rods. So various designs, but this is just a basic idea that I wanted to give you. So that's why I have just written four parallel rods. Ion separation is performed using controlled voltages applied to mass analyzer rods, which impart an electrostatic field inside the analyzer. So basically, voltages are applied, and then there is an electrostatic field that is generated, which controls the sorting of ions. Okay, these analyzers are comparatively less expensive and yield good reproducibility. Therefore, they are commonly used for quantification. But the disadvantage with quadrupole mass analyzer is that they have a low resolution. Now, when I say low resolution, what does resolution mean? See, we are talking about mass to charge ratio. So if I say that the mass to charge ratio of analyte A is, for example, let us say it is 100.1, okay? And when I say they have a low resolution, I'm saying it is 100.1. What happens if they have a very good resolution? You can determine the mass to charge ratio up to 4 decimals maybe. So it can come as 100.1234. So that is something. If a mass analyzer can give you mass to charge ratio as 100.1234, that is 4 decimal points, you can say that's a good mass analyzer. That is having high resolution. But quadrupole mass analyzers do not have high resolution. Now, this is very important. You must understand how exactly the quadrupole mass analyzer works, because I was told that most of the research students are working with quadrupole mass analyzers. I mean, when you give the sample to some lab which is not in your institute, you use quadrupole mass analyzers. Okay, so let us understand what is it. So you can see in the figure that is a Q1, then there is a collision cell and there is a Q2. Okay, now Q1 is the first filter. You can see the first quadrupole. So you can see also, you can also see the colored arrows. So these are nothing but various molecules that are entering in the Q1. Okay, so now I have taken these examples of various M plus ion, that is a molecular ion or the precursor ion. So I have taken these examples. Now imagine that in a situation you are analyzing something, and these are the various molecular ions that are generated: 265, 324, 301, etc. Now the analyte of your interest is actually a molecular ion of 324. Okay, so now what happens is that in the Q1, when everything enters, okay, it is fine. But when in the collision cell, when you want to pass your molecule of interest to collision cell, you have to select only 324. Okay, so you have to adjust the voltage on the Q1 in such a way that only 324 M plus molecule will enter the collision cell. Now, once it enters the collision cell, let us imagine that the 324 molecular ion splits into 129 and 101 as the two product ions, okay, major product ions, and also other small fragments like 154, 78. So this is all these 129, 101, 154. All these fragments are coming from 324. 324 is the analyte of your interest. Now, when you see the response of all these product ions, you come to know that the response of 129 and 101 is the highest. So you would select them for further study, and you will only say to the MS software that just pass 324 to 129 and 324 giving to 101. Only these two molecular species has to enter Q2. So this is in general, in a very basic form, this is quadrupole mass analyzer. Okay, now let us take the other example wherein I have chosen what is the beauty of this particular mass analyzer is that we've initially seen a mass of 324. Now let us say that there is a mass of 323 also. Now would you think that the quadrupole will get confused with this? No, it will not, because 324 will split into different product pattern, and 323 will give you different product pattern. So 324 is giving 129 and 109 as the product masses, whereas 323 is giving 154 and 78. If you want both these analytes, okay, then accordingly you can choose to have all the four species in the Q2, and accordingly the Q2 will only allow 129, 101, 154 and 78 to come to Q2. Okay, and that's how you are avoiding any other molecular species entering into Q2. Now you can see that here I've shown a complex. This is an example where a lot of peaks you can see and a lot of analytes are getting separated. Now just take this example, that the analyte number one, that in this case analyte the red one, okay, this retention time of this particular analyte and the second analyte, they're very close to each other, okay. So on a normal HPLC you probably would have struggled, okay, to separate them or to understand whether, you know, they are, this is just a one molecule or they're two different molecules, etc., etc. But in case of mass, this does not happen. Why? Because analyte one, okay, when it dissociates, when it ionizes and when it is subjected to collision, it forms a different set of productants. And analyte number two, it forms a different set of productants. And that is how you can distinguish between analyte one and analyte two, okay? Now, the only confusion can happen is that if you're dealing with isomers. If you're dealing with isomers, as you know that the isomers will have the same mass to charge ratio also. And mostly, not mostly, their properties are also same. So on a liquid chromatogram, normal conventional liquid chromatography, they will not be able to, we will not be able to resolve them. So only in those cases you have to take care. If it is extremely important for you to separate the isomers for whatever reason, you can use a chiral column. Okay. Now, how to develop LC-MS-MS method, which is based on MRM technique, that is the multiple reaction monitoring. Okay, multiple reaction monitoring is used only in cases where you have more than 10 or 15 molecules to be analyzed in one single run. Okay, and that too if you want to achieve a very, very low detection level. Okay, so what you do, but apart from that also you can use this same technique for single reaction monitoring as well. So what you have to do is, suppose that, let us take this particular example, that we have an analyte. Okay, you went to the literature survey, you found that the molecular weight is 323 and this particular molecule has a habit of protonation. So obviously the molecule that you, the M plus species that you would be seeing in LC-MS-MS is 324. So you select 324 as your analyte of interest. Now what you do is that now when you know that 324, you have a reference standard of your analyte. So what you do is that you take out the LC column and you just use a union. Okay, the union is directly connected to the mass spectrometer and you directly pass your solution of your certified reference material, okay, through the union. Now what happens here is that in the first step you only have to see whether you are getting the molecular ion, that is, are you able to get 324 as a response of 324 M/Z. When you get the response of 324, you know that it is working. The next step is, as I told you, that you have to go to the SIM mode. Now, when you go to the SIM mode, what you do is, you remember the pre-filter that I told you, the Q1. Okay, now since we are dealing with a standard, it is very easy. We know that it is just the 324 that is going in the mass. But imagine when you are dealing with the sample, there could be so many other constituents, okay, which will also try to enter the Q1. So how the Q1 will know that I have to pass 324 only? So for that, you have to optimize the fragmenter voltage, okay, of the Q1. So that is done using a SIM mode. Now what you do is that you put your mass as 324, okay, and you give various voltages to the fragmenter, you give various fragmenter voltages, okay. Now this procedure that I'm telling you is just a rough procedure, okay, and the terms that I'm using could be different from for some other instrument vendors, but you just have to understand the concept. Now once you optimize the SIM mode, okay, that is, you know that 324 is the mass to charge ratio that of your analyte, and for that particular mass to charge ratio you have optimized, meaning you have to check the maximum response, okay, that you get with different fragmenter voltages. If you find out that with 100 volts you're getting the maximum response, you fix 100 as your fragmenter voltage. Once you finalize that, then you have to come to productants, okay, because now what is going to happen is that this particular 324 ion is going to split into various productants. So you have to, how does this happen? This happens because you have a collision gas, okay, in the collision cell. So I have shown you that there's a collision cell. This collision cell actually has a collision gas. Oh no, I did not show you, sorry. Is it afterwards? Okay, I don't have a picture of it. Anyway, it doesn't matter. So the collision, so there is Q1, there is, I think this is itself. Yeah, so this is it. So collision gas I have written in the second diagram, second cell. So that collision gas also, the collision cell will also have collision energy. So you have to apply voltages also here in this case. So the mass of 324, okay, now will be mixed with collision gas, and we have to apply various collision energies, okay. And you have to optimize, okay, you have to optimize to find out which product ions are formed and to what abundance, to what concentration or to what probability. For example, let us take this example of 324, okay. I told you that 324, let us imagine that 324 is the mass that is giving product ions of 129, 101. So you will get, as you increase the collision energy, maximum breaking of 324 will happen, okay. But you have to remember that you don't have to completely break down 324, okay, because that will create problems. I'll tell you what problem it can lead to. So 324 is giving 129 and 101 as the maximum ions, okay. So you have to choose those. So now once you have finalized the product ions, okay, now you know that your precursor ion is giving you what product ions. And now you finally put everything in the MSMS method and you finalize your method. Once you do it in the union, through the union, you also have to use the HPLC stationary phase and you have to finalize it, okay. So when you choose two product ions, what we generally do is we select one product ion as the quantifier. Quantifier meaning on the basis of this quantifier ion, okay, the calibration graph will be plotted. So a transition of 324 going to 129 is considered for quantification, okay. And the second transition that you chose, that is 324 going back to 101, this one you can choose as a qualifier, okay. You should at least have one qualifier, okay. You can choose more as well. And all of this just to confirm, to make sure that the analyte of your interest is not getting mixed up. You are not confusing this with any other molecule, okay. So this is just for confirmation, and this is in fact the greatness of LC-MSMS, that it is widely accepted as a confirmatory technique, because you have first the retention time as a confirmation, okay. So if there is a molecule that is eluting at say 5 minutes, okay, there is a very and it has a molecular mass of 324, the possibility of having another molecule, okay, of 324 M by Z eluting at same retention time is really less, unless they're isomers. Okay, so that's the beauty of MS. Now, I have just given this example of one quantification process and how do you check the results, because I was told that students do not understand how to see the results. Just an example I have taken here is that we studied a tea sample for a polyphenol content, and we had the polyphenol CRN, okay, from Sigma. So this is the experiment that I have done, and just tell you how we did it. So first we developed the LC-MSMS method, basically the MS parameters. Okay, like I said, precursor ion was finalized. The polyphenol standard had multiple polyphenols. Okay, because polyphenol is not just one compound. It has gallocatechin, it has catechin, epigallocatechin, so many of them. So individually, we did literature survey. We found out what are the product ions that are typically formed, and accordingly optimize the MS method. So first we optimize precursor, then product ions with collision energy and voltage standardizations. Then we optimize the LC method, then LC method and optimize MS parameters together were run. Then we plotted the calibration graph and then we run the sample. This is the sample. Okay, you can see the total ion chromatogram. You can see on the left hand corner, it is written TIC, MRM. Okay, TIC means total ion chromatogram. So this is just like any other HPLC chromatogram. You can see in the table below, you can see quantitation results. Okay, so you have gallocatechin, caffeine, and you can see the RT, that is retention time. You can also see the response final concentration, because that is 1 ppm, because we had used 1 ppm standard of polyphenol. Okay, so that is 1 ppm. Now this is the TIC. Now how do you see the MRMs? Now I have taken just one example of gallocatechin. Okay, now the MSMS details are of gallocatechin are 305 is the molecular mass of gallocatechin, forms 125. Okay, and this is chosen as a quantifier because obviously the response of this transition was the best. Therefore, it was chosen as quantifier. And qualifiers were 221 and 219. Now, in the table, in the box below, you can see on the left-hand side with the green peak, you can see MRM into bracket, it's written 305 giving 125. Okay, so that's my quantifier. In the second middle window, you can see in the blue font, 305 giving 221. And in the green one, you can see 305 going giving 219. These are other product ions coming from 305. Okay. Again, the greatness of LC-MS is that there will be so many M by Z ratios. Okay, like 221. 221 can come from multiple sources. M by Z of 221, M by Z of 219, even 305, they can come from various sources. But why this particular MRM is important is that we are only seeing 221 coming from 305. And we are asking the detector to see 125 coming only from 305. Okay, so that is how it makes it very, very selective. Okay. You can also see in the bracket there are ratios in the second box. You can see ratio and you can also see percentages written. Okay, so what are these? These are nothing but the ratios of qualifier and quantifier. In the third window, you can see that on the right hand side there's a 305 mass. That's our molecular mass. Remember, we broke that using the collision gas. And you can see that 125, the response of 125 is maximum. That is why we've chosen it as quantifier. Response of 219 and 179 is less than that. And therefore, they become qualifier. Now, the ratio of 125 and 219, you can see that in front of 219, that is the green one, the one, you can see 52.3. It means that the response is almost 50%. Okay, and for the pink peak, it is 23%. So now this is the case of standard. So when we injected the standard polyphenol, this is what we got, and this is what we standardized. Okay, now the ratios, ion ratios, these are called ion ratios, qualifier and quantifier ratios. These, when you, whatever ratios you get in the standard, you should also get it in the sample. Okay, if the ratios are not matching in the sample, probably that's not the compound that you're looking at. Okay, so it is very important to compare the qualifiers also. But again, it depends on what you want to see. Okay, if your method does not require to check the qualifier, see, because this qualifier quantifier thing business becomes very important only when you are doing a multi-residue analysis. Wherein you are analyzing like 600 components at a time, or say 200 or more than 200 components at a time. That time it becomes very, very important because so many components are there, and masses of 125, 221, 219, they can come from any molecule, any species, and therefore you must make sure that apart from quantifier, you also check the qualifier. Now the next, this is the example of the sample. So we extracted the tea sample using suitable solvents, and you can see that on the left hand side, you can see that we have got a peak in the sample. And in the next window, you can see the ratios. Ratios are almost matching. So you can see that in the standard, I'll just go back to the standard. Just keep an eye on the ratio green one. Okay. Ratio in case of standard green is 52.3. Okay. That is 99.4%, and in the sample the ratio is 51.1 and it is 97%. What does that mean is that it is a peak of gallocutagen that we are seeing. So the ratios of the qual-quant ratio, the window that is acceptable is 80 to 120%. So 20% plus minus is okay. So meaning that if instead of 51.1, even if I get a response close to 80%, it is fine. We can still say that the analyte of interest is gallocutagen. So this is the tea sample. Okay. Now this is how you actually use and interpret the results coming from a quadrupole mass analyzer. So if you are giving your sample to a lab for conducting some MRM study or even single reaction monitoring, you must be able to see the calibration graph. Calibration graph is like any other calibration graph. Okay, you have to check the linear dynamic range. There should not be any plateauing, okay, all that has to be taken care. And but in addition to that, you also have to see the quantifier and the qualifier if you are dealing with multiple analytes, like antibiotic, multiple antibiotics in some animal origin product. You must see the qualifier also. The next set of analyzers is time of flight mass analyzers. A lot of students might have heard about this TOF, it is known as popularly. And what happens in TOF is that generally the ions, they fly, okay, or they drift down an evacuated tube of a particular length. And the ions are separated depending on their mass to charge. In the sense, everywhere it is mass to charge only, but the ions, for example, if you have a 325 mass and if you have a 125 mass, 125 mass is light and therefore it will reach the detector force. And 325 mass is heavy and therefore it will reach the detector later. So depending on the mass to charge ratio, okay, and how they fly in the system, who reaches the detector first, this is the way they are separated. So ions are extracted in short bursts, okay, within the ion source. And they are subjected to accelerating voltage. So when the ions are formed, they are given acceleration. All of them are given the same acceleration. And therefore, they fly down the evacuated tube. And once free from the region of accelerating voltage, the speed at which the ions fly down, okay, is dependent on the mass to charge ratio. Okay. And the advantage of this kind of a mass analyzer is that all the ions can be measured simultaneously. Now, in case of triple quadrupole, what is happening? We'll go back here. What is happening here in this case is that suppose your peak number one, you are saying it is 324, okay, transition of 324 to 129. So what in this case quadrupole is doing is that it is searching for this particular transition, 324 to 129, okay, throughout the 14 minutes. And therefore, it is neglecting the other transitions, okay. Now, this is not the case in case of TOF. You can analyze all the mass to charge ratios simultaneously. Of course, please don't think that therefore quadrupole mass analyzers are not to be used. There is a solution to address this issue also. Okay, what here we can do is that we can use something which is known as a dynamic MRM. If you know that your analyte number one always eludes between 1.5 to 2.5, okay, you can ask the mass detector to search for the transition 324 to 129. Only from 1 to 2 minutes. And that's how you improve the sensitivity of the quadrupole. But this is a separate part. But the beauty of TOF is that it will analyze, it will detect everything. Okay, so this is the picture. Okay, so you can also see that mass analyzer, the scanning is very fast in mass, in TOF. Okay, and it has a very high sensitivity. You can see the heavy ones, they're lacking behind, and the light ones are going ahead first. Okay, and in some cases, this is a linear time of flight mass analyzer. You can also have a reflectron. So what is done is that the path is basically prolonged. So you have a separate path is given to the ions apart from this linear path, so that everything can be separated. So it has a very high mass resolution. I have given the example like analyte M by Z. For example, analyte, a particular analyte has a mass to charge ratio of 356.2123. And apart from that analyte, there is a matrix that is also coming in the in mass and has a mass to charge ratio of 356.2347. Now, if you compare again with the quadrupole, quadrupole will not be able to distinguish probably between, it will not be in fact. Okay, now here we have to assume that the retention time of both these analyte and matrix are the same, and that is why it is creating trouble in quadrupole. If the retention times are different, you can very well separate these components in quadrupole. Okay, but when the situation is that they are both eluting at the same retention time and their masses are almost same, they are not exactly same but almost same, these also will be separated in TOF. Okay, so apart from that, there are other advantages of TOF, like it is compatible with other techniques, like it is compatible with other separation modules also, and it is it is being used in a lot of research institutes because it is very easy to design and very easy to handle. Okay, and it has a very high mass resolution, like I told you this one. Okay? The next is the ion trap. Ion trap also is a very nice mass analyzer. It works on the basis of sorting the ions in the trap. So as the name suggests, there is a trap, and all the ions that are generated are trapped actually. Okay, in physically they are trapped in the mass analyzer, and the sorting is done by manipulating the DC and RF fields. The amplitude of the applied voltages enables the analyzers to trap the ions of specific mass to charge ratio within the device. Okay, so the analytes which are neutral or which do not which are non what do you say which are not important to us, they are given a different trajectory and they are allowed to exit the trap. Okay, now the disadvantage of this particular technique is that since everything is there in the trap, okay, there could be some cross reactions also, okay, and between the various species, okay, they can also interact because there is a collision gas also in the trap, and there are other species also, so there is there could be some interactions, and that can also give rise to some unnecessary molecular species. Okay, they can also generate some unnecessary species, okay, and therefore you can get unusual spectra. So this is a disadvantage, but the advantage on the other hand is that you can do multiple fragmentation of a particular species. So like 324 going to 109, okay, now once that is done, we cannot again split 109 to other small fragments in quadrupole, okay, or in time of flight, but in ion trap mass analyzer this is possible. So you can actually have multiple fragmentations done in ion trap analyzers. Okay, so for research activities this could be very helpful. This is the example diagram basically. Okay. So you can see the trapped ions, okay, and we can see that everything is inside the trap, and you apply, you basically play with the RF and DC voltage, okay, to allow the exit of ions, okay. And these ions then will then go to the mass detector, to the detector, not the mass detector, the detector. So now how do you choose a mass analyzer? Okay, now if for example, if you look at quadrupole, what is the advantage? It has a very good reproducibility, and quadrupoles, they work wonders when you know what is the analyte of your interest. So for known compounds and to quantify known compounds, nothing works better than quadrupole. And if you are using MRMs, multiple reaction monitoring, okay, they will work very, very well. Okay, they also have a very good reproducibility. They have a relatively small, and they are relatively small, like the space they occupy is relatively small, and also they are not so costly. Okay, and as I told you earlier, that they can be used for quantification very well. Okay. So if you see all the regulatory requirements coming from European Union, okay, they all generally recommend quadrupole, okay, triple quadrupoles. The next is the TOF. It is the fastest mass analyzer, and it is best for those wherein you do not know, okay, what are the analytes in the sample, okay, so analysis of unknown molecules. Because everything that is generated in the TOF is finally analyzed. That is why it is good for analysis of unknown molecules. And TOF generally is used by regulatory bodies wherein they want to regulate the, for example, I can share this one incident is that every year in India, we export a lot of grapes to European Union. And farmers here, sometimes they do use some pesticides which are not authorized, okay, to be used in the grape samples. And now if you only restrict to quadrupole, we know that X, Y, Z, these are the pesticides that we have to check in the grape sample, okay. But if the farmer has used something, okay, which is not recommended, we will never look for those particular pesticides in the quadrupole. But TOF can do it, okay. So what you do is that you analyze the extract on the TOF and you will get more M by Z ratios. Then you go back to the library of TOF. The TOF, I would say requirement of a library is a must for TOF. because then you can actually find out which molecule you are looking at, then you can do further investigation. So regulatory bodies, research activities, all these cases, TOF is very useful. When you come to ion trap, it has the highest mass resolution, okay, even better than TOF, okay. And as I told you earlier, it is capable of doing multiple fragmentations, okay, more than 1, 2, 3 fragmentations. Then it is well suited for pulsed ionization methods. Pulsed ionization method is nothing but MALDI. Okay, so generally MALDI TOF is very popular because TOF also can is very well suited for pulsed ionization methods. So MALDI TOF is very popular, and even ion trap with MALDI also is being used. Now the detector of mass detector. Okay, so now once the ions have passed the mass analyzer, they have to be detected and transformed into a signal. Okay, and there are various types of detectors: electron multiplier detector, photographic plate. There is a Faraday cup. And there is a scintillating counter, okay, but generally EMD, that is electron multiplier, is popularly used. When a charge, what happens here is that when a charge ion strikes the detector surface, like now from the collision cell, it goes to the Q2, and from Q2 it goes to detector. Now when this charge species strikes the detector surface, it causes the release of secondary ions from the surface of the detector, and the number of secondary electrons produced depends on the type of primary incident particle and its energy. So if there are 10 species that are done, and in some cases it is 20, okay, depending on that the signal is produced. Basically it is just extrapolation of the signal. The important aspect of the MS-MS system, any MS-MS system, is a vacuum system, okay. And for good working of any MS, okay, be it TOF, be it quadrupole, ion trap, any, vacuum system is a must. Okay, so what it does is that, why is it important? Because it provides an adequate mean free path for the ions. There is no collision, okay, because there are no particles, there is no gas, there is nothing, okay, in the entire system, and therefore collisions are avoided, unnecessary collisions are avoided. Collisions which are happening in the collision cell has to happen, they have to happen, but I'm saying at the other places, like in the Q1 or in the Q2. Then also they work by reducing ion molecule interactions and by reducing the background reference. So mass will never work without the vacuum. 10^-4 torr is required generally, okay, for triple quadrupole systems. And just another, basically you have to keep checking the vacuum system. And in case of mass analyzers, what happens is that generally if you put down the vacuum, the system will be affected, and if you want to use the system again, you at least have to wait for 1 or 2 days till you get a very, very good background. A very, very good background in the sense, no background, okay? So that is why maintaining the vacuum is very important. The next aspect that I would like to mention here is the matrix effect. A lot of students are probably not aware, or maybe aware, but they do not know what does it mean, matrix effects. Now, matrix effects are very prominent in any mass spectrometer, GC-MS or LC-MS. And these were first observed by some scientist in 1993, Key Barley. And he observed that the accuracy and precision of analytes were significantly compromised due to unknown matrix components in the analyte extract. Now, he also observed that the matrix effects cause signal enhancement in case of GC-MS and signal suppression, okay, in case of LC-MS. So matrix effects therefore play an important role, okay, in any mass analysis, and especially more important if you are using a multi-residue analysis. Okay, so I'll tell you what matrix effect is. So for example, if I make a particular solution of a standard in say acetonitrile or any other suitable solvent, and if I make the same standard in the if I'm seeing the same analyte in the sample, okay, a sample extract, you can say, there's a difference in the response. So the analyte in standard response, you can see, is very high, and analyte in sample response is very low. It is the same amount of analyte, okay, but still the response is different. Why is this happening? Okay, this is happening because of the matrix, and that is why, because the sample has matrix, and that is why it is known as matrix effect. And we'll see what exactly it is. What happens is that if you are dealing with the food products, let us say you are dealing with the say you want to find out what is the aflatoxin present in say a cereal sample or in a soybean sample or in a whatever sample. Okay, so the food matrix itself, okay, has so many components. Okay, like soybean hai, yeah, whatever your spices, all of them will have their own components, which are known as matrix components. So they will also compete because they will also be getting eluted through the HPLC. Okay, it is not that nothing is getting eluted apart from an analyte. Okay, the very fact that the fact that you are not able to see them does not mean, okay, you may not see a chromatogram, but they are still there. Okay, so the matrix components also compete with the analyte. Okay, for charge. So they also want to get ionized. Then they either increase or decrease the surface tension. They increase or decrease the solvation of analyte, and they affect the evaporation of solvents. Okay, so because of, for example, if your sample has salts, okay, salts will try and they will inhibit the evaporation process. So these matrix components finally will affect ionization. Okay, and when ionization is affected, the entire process is affected because it is the starting point of MS. So yeah, so in short, matrix components affect ionization of analytes. Now, what factors affect the matrix effect? The first is the type of matrix. For example, there are some matrices which are very plain and simple, like water. You will not see much of matrix effects in water because it's just a plain matrix. But if you consider, say, a turmeric sample or a chili sample, it has so many components. It has volatile acids, it has flavonoids, it has so many other things. So all of those matrix components will compete with the analyte of your interest for getting ionized. The type of matrix is very important. The second is the type of analyte molecule. Okay, there are some analyte molecules which are not affected because of any matrix. Okay, then the ionization technique, whether you are making the ionization in the condensed form or in the gas phase, that will also affect the ionization. That will also affect the interference coming from matrix. And the next is the sample preparation method. Okay, what sample preparation method are you using? Okay, are you introducing any salts in your sample? Okay, or are you introducing any other impurities in your sample which will finally compete with your analyte for ionization? So all these things will matter and they will affect the matrix effect. How do you study the matrix effect? Matrix effects, basically there is a formula. Okay, so the percent matrix effect is given by the formula slope of matrix match curve into 100 upon slope of solvent only curve. When I'm saying all this, please remember I'm saying again and again is that this will be extremely important if you are using a multi-residue method, in the sense you are trying to analyze more than say 50 components at a time and they are very closely separated or closely eluting compounds. So what happens is that you do not, since you have multiple compounds, you have a limitation of optimizing your LC gradient. Okay, so when you cannot play much with the LC gradient, okay, you will have to face the matrix effects. So how do you get rid of those matrix effects? We will see that also later. But how you first find out whether your sample analyte is facing matrix effects? So what you do is you prepare a calibration graph in the solvent standard and you prepare a calibration graph in the matrix match curve, in the sense you, instead of using the solvent for dilution, you use matrix for dilution. For example, if you are using turmeric is the matrix that you are working on and you want to find out toxin in the turmeric, for example, then you subject the turmeric matrix to the same process, okay, and you come out with the matrix of the turmeric and you prepare your calibration curve in the turmeric blank and you compare the result. Okay, you find out the slope of the matrix match curve and you find out the slope of the solvent curve, and this formula will give you the percent matrix effects. Generally, the values which are above 100% indicate that there is a enhanced ionization. It is meaning that it is going more than 100. It is enhanced ionization. If it's less than 100, it is signal suppression. We don't want any of these ideally. Okay, and generally matrix effects which are in the range of 80 to 120 are considered to be suitable. So you can actually not go for matrix match standard, okay, if the matrix effect values are between 80 to 120%. Okay, I have just shown one example here. Now what this example shows here, on the left hand side it shows the slope ratio, that is nothing but the matrix effect, and on the x axis there are multiple pesticides. Okay, they have called them pesticide IDs, and there are various matrices. So they have studied various matrices for pesticide residue. You can see across extremely up there, okay, that belongs to cabbage. So probably there is this pesticide ID 120, okay, ID number 120, which has enhanced matrix effects for this particular pesticide only, and that too in the cabbage only. If you see the red dot at around in between 2 and 2.5, that belongs to onion. Okay, then if you go down, the blue triangles, they all belong to spinach. So in case of spinach, you can see that there is generally a signal suppression happening. Okay, so this is just one way of finding out whether your matrix components are interfering with ionization or not, but it is important, of course, for you to find that out. Another example of celery. You can see on the left hand side, now what this graph tells you is that there are two different samples. I told you that matrix effects can be controlled, or they depend on the sample preparation method. So here in this case, they have compared two sample preparation methods. The left hand side, it is just celery, which is just crushed and diluted in some organic solvent and run in HPLC on LC-MS/MS. And on the right hand side, you have a Quetcher's method being adopted for celery pesticide residue analysis. You can see on the left hand side, a lot of signal enhancement can be seen because all of them are up. Okay. And towards the end, there is a little more of enhancement, signal enhancement. And on the right hand side, when you use the Quetcher's method, you can see that signal enhancement is not there. In some cases, there is some signal suppression. Okay. So this is how you interpret the matrix effect. And celery, why it is? Because it does not have a very high fat content, and it is, you know, in fact it has a very high water content, and therefore it is quite, you can also see that it is not, very few cases it is going plus minus above 20% or less than 20%. It is showing that basically you may not consider the matrix effects for celery. They are not much. Okay, so this is with celery. But if you take an example of avocado, or as I said, turmeric. If you take such examples, you can see there is a lot of signal enhancement on the left hand side when you just dilute the avocado sample and just run it on LC-MS/MS. Okay, you can see a lot of signals coming out. And on the left hand side, if you apply a Quetcher's method for avocado sample, you can see that the signal enhancement is reduced to a very great extent. Okay, so this is how you study your matrix effects. Yeah. How do you overcome? Okay, so basically what you have to do is you have to reduce the amount of co-eluting compounds. Okay, if you can do that, you can overcome the matrix effects. How do you use that? Okay, you can see, when do you introduce the co-eluting compounds? Either they are there in the matrix itself, or you introduce them during the sample preparation. Okay, so therefore there is also a trend wherein people believe that no sample preparation has to be done for analysis. Just dilute the sample and use a sensitive instrument to analyze. That way you will not introduce any new components in the system. So that is sample dilution followed by use of sensitive instrument. The second is beta cleanup. Okay, whereas some people believe that if there is a lot of fat in the sample, or if there is a lot of sugar, these components need to be removed. So you have to use a beta cleanup method. Okay, so you can, depending on what matrix you are using, what analyte you want to target, you can decide any of these techniques. It is not that every time better sample cleanup is going to work. Okay, these are just various alternatives that you can use. Reducing the injection volume, of course, if you introduce less sample, you will find less co-eluting compounds. Using matrix match standard that I have explained. Then using isotope labeled internal standards. For example, if you are dealing only, now you cannot use isotope labeled internal standards for a multi-residue analysis, because you are analyzing more than 50, maybe 100, 200 analytes. You cannot afford, okay, to buy isotope labeled internal standards for all of them. So these standards can be used only in cases where you are dealing only with a couple of compounds. Okay, and wherein bi-isotope level standards they work, because they also elute at the same retention time as the analyte of your interest. So you're the analyte of your interest, whatever competition the analyte of your interest is facing will be faced by the internal standard as well. And therefore, it can compensate for that matrix effect. So this is about matrix effects. So now, in all, what I have done is I have just told you what is the basic of LC-MS-MS and basically more of quadrupole, because quadrupole is widely used. And what are matrix effects? You also have to remember that. If you're dealing only with a couple of compounds, you only have one analyte of interest, you need not really bother for matrix effect, because in that case, you can change the gradient in such a way that it eludes at a retention time where there is least matrix interference. Okay, so you have to remember that. Now just quickly see, let us see the pros and cons. As I told you earlier, it is very, very specific and very selective. It's very sensitive also, and very sensitive in the sense that a lot of people get confused between definition of sensitivity. Basically, sensitivity is when your instrument responds to a very small change in the concentration. If it is able to detect that change also, okay, like going from 1 ppb to 2 ppb, if your instrument can detect this change, you can say that your instrument is sensitive. Okay, then it can do multi-residue analysis, and therefore it has high throughput. Like instead of analyzing two pesticides on one machine or on one method, three pesticides on GC, two pesticides on LC, okay, you can just club all of them together, and therefore I'm saying that this is a high throughput method. And what are the disadvantages or the cons? High capital investment. Yes, the cost of LC-MS-MS, they are close to 1 crore, maybe more than that. In fact, more than that. And also they require a high operational cost, in the sense that first that I told you is that they have to be always put under vacuum, okay, so that there is no background noise and there is no interference coming from the background. Okay, so you have to put them on 24/7. Now, when you put them on for 24/7, you always have to use air conditioned rooms because the pump gets heated up. So that's an operational cost, 24/7 ACs. The type of solvents that you use for LC-MS-MS, they also have to be of high quality, high purity. That also is a cost. Okay, so therefore I say it is high operational cost. And the next is the trained manpower. Okay, so a lot of people, they cannot interpret the result, especially TOF results or ion trap results, quadrupole results also in some cases, they cannot develop the methods. So you need to have trained manpower, and to maintain the trained manpower also is a cost. So applications in food industry, basically if you talk about food industry or even for your research projects, I would say there are two basic sections wherein we need analysis. Nutritional and contaminants. So for you, basically that is quality. Nutritional is nothing but quality, and contaminant analysis is nothing but ensuring safety. So for quality and safety, we have nutritional and contaminant analysis. I mean, nutritional analysis, there are vitamins, there are botanical actives. You are aware that FSSAI has allowed botanical actives, and we have so many natural or herbs that we use. But the actives of these compounds are unknown, or not much work has been done. So for those all analysis also, you can use LC-MS-MS. Then there are proteins, of course, there are oligosaccharides. All of these can be analyzed in using LC-MS-MS. And contaminants, why they are useful? Because generally for contaminants, there are stricter government regulations. Okay. And the levels of contaminants, the maximum residues of contaminants that are allowed in food products, they are generally in the range of microgram per kg, that is ppb. And mass detectors can detect these small levels of contaminants, and therefore they can be used for pesticide residues, antibiotics, mycotoxins, and other process contaminants. You can use the LC-MS-MS. Now, we just like to draw your attention to a couple of more applications wherein LC-MS-MS can be used. These are the emerging applications. There is work that is happening in this area, but it is not still like commercialized. But as research students, you must know. The first area which is emerging is the proteomics. Okay, so wherein what is done is we identify and characterize the complete set of proteins present in a food sample. Okay, so the entire protein set of a sample is food sample is studied. That is called complete proteome. Okay, and this or a subset of the protein. Okay, like for example, sarcoplasmic gluten or glycosylated proteins. Okay. And what is the application in food industry is that the total protein content of a biological system is highly dynamic. Okay, because depending on the state, the storage, you know, the shelf life, everything is changing. So they are highly dynamic and is constantly changing. Okay, and proteins can act as indicators for many properties associated with food quality, composition, okay, or origin. Proteins can act as indicators for detecting adulterants. So all of this can be, of course, this is just emerging and a lot of work also has to be done in this area so that it can be used commercially. Okay. But LC-MS, MS can be used. TOF is being used for these applications. Yes, MALDI-TOF. Yes. So example here is that adulteration in mozzarella cheese. Mozzarella is a very highly priced cheese. Okay, and it is very, very expensive, but it is adulterated with cheap, whey protein substitutes. But how do you detect that? Okay, you can detect that by MALDI-TOF. Okay, and other example is adulteration of UHT milk, okay, to raw or pasteurized milk. So these adulterations also can be detected using protein analysis. The next is, and this is for MALDI-TOF, for ESI, that is electrospray ionization MS-MS, you can study adulteration of soya bean proteins to meat. See these examples, somebody has studied these examples and have research papers have been published for these examples, and therefore I'm sharing these with you. ESI MS-MS also can be used for meat speciation. Okay, pork, beef, sheep, you want to know whether exactly it is a pork meat that you are eating or a beef or whatever. And the next is metabolomics. So there is proteomics and there is metabolomics. Metabolomics, as the name suggests, is nothing but the study of metabolites. Metabolites generally are low molecular weight, and they also tell you a lot of things about the food sample. Okay, so metabolome consists of various things, like it consists of ionic inorganic species, hydrophilic compounds, organic acids, amino, small amino acids, okay, lipids, okay, and volatile components, carbohydrates, sugars, okay, so a lot of metabolome components are present, and these can be used in the food authenticity area. Okay, metabolomics has a very high potential in food authenticity. We will see what example. For example, if you take wine, okay, grape variety authentication. Okay, people need a wine coming only from a particular grape variety. Okay, so how do you know that the wine is coming only from that grape variety? You study the metabolome of the wine and save it in the library. So you generate, if you want Thompson's grape variety wine, okay, you map the entire metabolome of the grape variety Thompson and the wine also, and then you save it in the library. And then if you have a doubt that the wine is not from the grape variety of your choice, you can study the metabolome and you can see the differences. So you come to know that whether it's the same variety or not. Okay, so likewise, you can also authenticate the fruit juice sources, okay, whether it's orange, pineapple, whatever. Authentication of beer. Honey is a major area because honey, a lot of adulteration is done in honey. Okay, and the claims are made that it is this particular honey, Alps honey, whatever. But all those also can be finally found out through mapping the metabolome. Okay, so these are some interesting applications, and I think that brings me to the end of this session. Would like to thank Department of Nutraceuticals, Dr. Gauri, and other faculty members of Khalsa College for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much. And would also like to say thank you to my colleague Ms. Soumya Nair for technical support and for providing me various chromatograms and other important literature. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a wonderful and informative session. I would now like to start with the question and answer session. There are a few questions. I'll read it one by one.
Yeah.
The first question is, what is the difference between MALDI and MALDI-TOF MS? And what is the effectiveness of MALDI-TOF MS in clinical practice?
MALDI, when I say MALDI, it is just the ionization technique. Okay. So when I say MALDI, it is just the ionization technique. When I say MALDI-TOF MS, it means the complete solution. So ionization is being done in MALDI. The ionized molecules are being sorted in TOF mass analyzer. Okay. And if you're asking me about clinical studies, clinical studies also MALDI-TOF can be used. You can study various proteins, you know, in the serum sample or in the blood sample, and how they behave, you know. And so I think it can be used for clinical studies as well. Basically, if you're dealing with proteins, peptides, oligosaccharides, you can use MALDI-TOF.
Okay, ma'am. Can we find individual proteins from complexes using MALDI techniques?
Since my generalized question, I don't know which protein, which technique, I mean, which matrix you're talking about. But you should, provided you have sufficient data, literature on it, and you have made a library of the protein, you will have to refer to a lot of other things also. Because like GCMS-MS has a library, it does not come by default with MALDI, or you will have to make it. Okay, or if it comes also, it come at a cost.
The next question is, for small molecules like metabolites, what is more preferable, TOF or quadrupol?
Of course, quadrupol, anytime. See, because TOF specializes in sorting high molecular weight compounds. You should not, because TOF, the cost of TOF is way higher than quadrupol. So if you can get something using TOF, you can get something using quadrupol, why should you go for TOF? So you have to reserve TOF only for proteins, you know, MALDI-TOF for proteins, peptides, oligosaccharides, or something that you're not aware, okay? Analysis of unknown compounds. You should reserve TOF for that.
The next question is, do we have to choose mass analyzer depending upon the sample?
It's just not sample. Also, what, like, for example, if you want to find out the assay, if you want to do assay, okay, why would you use MS? You have HPLC, you have titrations, you have GC. So mass is used only for two reasons. One reason is that you want to achieve lowest possible detection levels, that is microgram per kg, micrograms, this ppb or even ppt level analysis you want to do. Okay, so this will be only possible for contaminants, because generally contaminants, we seek them at a very lower level. So in that case, you can use LC-MS-MS. Or for unknown analysis, you can use LC-MS-MS. So depending on what, I mean, analyte you are working, what matrix, what is the aim of your study, it all will guide, it will govern the choice.
Okay, ma'am. Why is there a difference in the matrix effect between LC-MS and GC-MS seen? One is suppressed and one is enhanced. Why?
Yeah, because the way the ionization happens, okay? And also, you have to also have to consider the in case of GC-MS, what is happening is that all this ionization is taking, I mean, the liner, the injector plays a very important role. Injector has a liner, and that liner also plays a very important role. A lot of analyte and the matrix is actually taken up by the liner, and therefore there is enhancement in GC-MS-MS. The structure of GC-MS-MS and LC-MS-MS is different, okay, and that is why in GC-MS it is enhancement, okay, because the liner would only absorb a lot of matrix and analyte.
Okay, ma'am. In quadrupol mass analyzer, 324-129 and 324-101 was selected as it was showing greater response. So the question is, why not 324-154?
Because it did not show a good response. See, when you want to achieve a lowest possible levels of detection, okay, you should seek very good response. So you would obviously select something that is giving you more response.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Yes. I extracted hormone metabolites in methanol. I optimized the separation method in HPLC, and now I want to identify the metabolites for quantification. Which one is best suitable for identification?
Which one is best suitable? I think the question is about which mass analyzer, whether it is quadrupole or quad. This is what I assume. So if you're dealing with a hormone that is studied by somebody else, okay, literature survey will give you details. Okay, and if you're dealing something which is not studied before any time, then probably we'll have to go with top. For known analyze, okay, like for example, I know that in a vegetable sample, I will find pesticides which are allowed in India, for example. So I know what I'm looking for, okay. But take the example of melamine, okay. Now, nobody thought that in milk sample, you have to look for melamine, because melamine was being added to milk, okay, to increase the protein content. So how would anyone know that melamine is to be seen? I don't know melamine is to be seen in milk. Okay, so for known analyze and in the known matrix, you would always use quadrupole. But something which is unusual, you have to go with that.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. I would like to offer the vote of thanks now. Firstly, I would like to thank our esteemed speaker, Dr. Preeti Amritkar, ma'am, for delivering such an amazing and informative session. The concept of such a complicated topic was explained in a very easier form with examples. Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like to thank EnviroCare Labs for their support in helping us conduct the webinar. I would also like to thank our principal, sir, Dr. Kiran Mangaukar, for always encouraging and supporting us. I would like to thank our HOD, Dr. Gauri Wahalkar, for being the guiding force throughout the webinar. I would also like to extend my gratitude to my colleagues, Ms. Subhashini Maharana, ma'am, and Ms. Aditi Vichare, ma'am, for looking after the entire proceedings. This webinar would be incomplete without the technical support of our IT team. Thank you, Alvin sir, Shyam sir, and Ashish sir. And lastly, I would like to thank our participants for such an overwhelming response. A small announcement regarding the feedback form and certificates. Feedback form link will be provided on the WhatsApp group, as well as it would be posted in the description box of the YouTube. You will be receiving the certificates within the next 15 days. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Hello.
Yes.
Thanks, Suhana. I should like to add one line. I really thankful to Dr. Preeti Amritkar, being she's taking care of entire labs and looking after different applications and all, and she taken out so much time and simplified the way we have discussed to the participants or the audience. And I will like to add, as EnviroCare Labs has also all the sophisticated analytical instrument which we are discussing now, such as LC-MS, MS, GC-MS, MS, OES, and all. And one more I want to add is, madam is entrepreneur herself. Again, that she's a researcher, she's a guide, she's a trainer. So many things she's doing at all once. So it is a great opportunity for me, or rather I'm taking from the Department of Nutraceuticals, so that we got that speaker like madam. Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Hello, Aldrin sir.
Hello, Ashish. Ashish
sir, we are done. We can just close the live session.